Thank you, sir, for that exhaustive introduction. I'm a plastic surgeon, basically a plastic surgeon. I'm at Rela Hospital in Krompet. My topic is puke versus blood supply. My idea is just to give an introduction of what we do as a plastic surgeon and our thinking as we go ahead with cases. Beauty in human form has been our obsession through the ages. The rest in India, as such, multiple examples we have. What is beauty? Small quotation. For three things concur in creating beauty. First of all, integrity or perfection. Then proper proportion, and finally clarity and light. It is simplistic. Three things: perfection, no deformities; proportion, symmetry and proportion according to each other parts; and finally clarity, simplicity of forming. And these things, is to maintain these things, is where we come in as a plastic surgeon, is to attempt to restore or enhance the perfect human form. What do we do? Basically, it's handle deformities or defects, congenital defects, post-trauma defects, disturbance, any disturbance in the ideal beautiful normal, as in trauma or other diseased states, and finally enhancing symmetry as in asthesis. Also, we deal with functional reconstruction, any function, especially of the hand or other parts of the body. How do we approach a problem if you are familiar with a very popular series, A Game of Thrones? This picture shows this main Jon Snow. He's approaching a dragon. So this is how we approach any problem, with lot of tentativeness. We don't know how it will react. We approach it with lot of hesitation. So what do we do when we get a problem, when we get a defect? The basic tenets: diagnose the problem, see functional defect, is it an anatomical defect, work out a plan according to the requirements, functional reconstruction, anatomical reconstruction, and finally go ahead and do what needs to be done. Acknowledge your limitations, and the final basic tenet is do no harm to the patient. Many times our thinking goes 3-4 steps above what is actually required, and in few instances, we end up doing more harm to the patient than what the patient requires. And in this, basically what we need to see is listen to the patient, because our idea of what is perfect for the patient is different. Whereas the patient comes with a different understanding of what he requires. So always listen to the patient and modify your plan according to what he requires. I'll just walk through three cases. It will be only photographs and explanations of photographs. Just basics of what we do as a plastic surgeon. The first case, this is a patient with an oral malignancy, a 56-year-old male. He had a floor of mouth malignancy impinging into the inner surface of the mandible. It was diagnosed with biopsy, planned for segmental mandibulectomy and neck dissection by the oncosurgeon. And this was the incision which the oncosurgeon had gone in through. This is a descriptive photograph, not the actual patient photograph. And this is the defect which we had to deal with. UL is the upper lip. This is the tongue. This is the lower lip. And behind this piece of gauze is the piece of the mandible. What we see here is the mandible which has been swung out, showing the defect. Here is the mandible. The inner aspect of the mandible has the lesion. This is basically the same photograph as before, but this shows the mandible. This is the median end of the mandible. This is the mandible which has been swung out with a lesion. You can see the lesion there. So here, this is the resected specimen. Again, this is the lesion. Now, diagnosing the problem, the basic defect is an anatomical defect with a functional aspect also, which involves chewing. So, what are the units which are involved? Basically, we need to replace or reconstruct the bone, and if possible with a teeth. The mucosa, the inner aspect of the surface, and finally the muscle. And since it is on the face, and since it involves the face, asthesis is a major concern. What are the requirements? We need, first of all, well-vascularized tissue. And here is where we come across our limitation, which is blood supply. We look for beauty, but finally the limitation we have is the blood supply. So we need well-vascularized tissue. The reason here why it's very important for vascularized tissue is this patient can go ahead for radiation post-operatively. And tissue which is not well vascularized just melts during radiation. So what we need is bone, the foundation, and if possible, as much as possible, three different segments so we can give approximate shape to the face, to the mandible. Mucosal replacement and finally teeth. And teeth we can bring in later. And all these requirements are brought in by a flap which we call as the fibula osteocutanis flap. Now, since we're talking about flaps, just a brief description of what a flap is. Last week's sessions we keep talking about this flap, muscle flap, bone flap, skin flap. What is a flap? Basically, is angiosome is a composite block of tissue, any tissue which is supplied by its own blood supply, and we can apply this to flaps also. A flap is any bit of tissue, it can include bone, muscle, skin, which has its own independent blood supply. And this flap is where, example is this, for example, by all these tissues, muscles, skin, all of these are supplied by one individual blood vessel, which has branches. So according to our requirement, if we need skin and subcutaneous tissue, we can harvest this branch and take this as a separate flap. If we need both, we can take the whole thing. In many aspects, when we have a bone involved, we can take it along with the bone. And these are the many angiosomes, the blood vessels. We call them perforators, which I described, around 380 of them, which I described in the human body, and these are particularly to the skin and subcutaneous tissue. And this is usually any bit of tissue is supplied by the main vessel, which gives branches into the muscle, bone if it is there, which goes further on through perforators, which perforate through the muscle or the intermuscular septum to the skin. And according to our requirements, if we require only skin subcutaneous tissue, then we can take this bit of tissue based on the blood vessel. If we need just muscle, so we can just harvest the muscle along with the blood supply, and again, muscle, skin, and blood vessel. And if we need bone, as in this case, we need bone also. So we take bone which is attached and supplied by the common vessel. Coming back to what we did, we had harvested a fibula, osteocutaneous flap. This flap has the bone, which is a fibula, and the skin. And here we did not require muscle, so we did not harvest the muscle. So this is the bit of skin which was taken. This bit of skin was used to reconstruct the mucosal aspect and the bone for the bony reconstruction. And this is what we call as perforators, the small blood vessel here. So this whole bit of tissue which I show the next slide is taken based on the coronal vessel, which gives off blood supply to the fibula. It has a perforator coming to the skin and subcutaneous tissue, and based on this small blood vessel, we can take the skin and subcutaneous tissue. And this is what we had harvested. There's a bone here. This is a blood vessel with branches into the bone and into the skin and subcutaneous tissue. And finally, we, like I showed in the picture, the bone was split into three segments, and using this reconstruction plate, and this plate is to give a shape to the mandible. Using this reconstruction plate, we fix the bone segments onto this plate using multiple screws. And here we can see the skin which we have harvested, the skin pattern, which is used for the mucosal reconstruction. Again, from the lower aspect, you can clearly see the bone segments, one segment here, one segment there, and one more segment there, which has been covered by muscle. This is the neck muscles, by the way. We did not harvest any muscle with the flap. The neck muscles were put in there to give some amount of support. And this is the final, when we finish the surgery and close the whole thing, this is how it looked like. And Postoperatively, this is the picture which he has. The patient before he had undergone surgery, this is how he is now. He has lost a lot of weight following the surgery, but to an extent we were able to give him a good shape of the jaw. He is able to eat soft diet. We have not gone ahead and put in the dental implants yet. The advantage with a vascularized bone is that after a period of a year or so, we can give him dental implants. We can implant teeth into the bone. And that is yet to be done. It's 7 months now following the surgery, and this is how he is now. The next case, a 35-year-old lady. She was in the recent rains, she was walking in the road, and there was a puddle on the ground, and she had to jump laterally. And when she made that visit jump, there was a crane which was passing by which ran over her foot. She was brought to an emergency with skin degloved from the foot. There are no major injuries to other parts of the body, and this was how she was brought. In this picture, you can see the skin. Skin is completely degloved off the foot, around the ankle and the posterior aspect of the foot. On examination again, foot is degloved from above ankle to the forefoot. The toes are intact and uninjured. There are no fractures in the toes. The vascularity, one important thing which we look at such injuries is the blood supply to the distal part. And for her luck and by God's grace, she did not have any vascularity issues. The blood vessels were intact. She had a median manual fracture which had been fixed by the orthopedic surgeon. The first stage, what we need to do is debridement. Keep the whole area, the devitalized tissue, the tissue which is not going to survive, remove the whole thing. Remove all the contaminants, the sand, mud, what all is there. There was extensive loss of skin and subcutaneous tissue in this whole area. The main important thing which we look at is there was loss of heel pad. Now the heel and the skin and subcutaneous tissue of the heel is something which you don't have in any other part of the body, except maybe the palm, but in a smaller area. So the thing is, the heel supports the whole weight of the body. It gives us good traction, it supports our weight, and it covers that bony area. It just takes the whole pressure of the body from the bone and passes it on. Again, finally, bones and tendons are exposed. Here we see that the median malleolar fracture with a little bit of bone loss was present. The lateral aspect of the defect. And here you can see a complete heel, the calcaneum is completely exposed. Few tendons are exposed here and there. So in this case, what we went ahead and did was, okay, the requirements were again well vascularized tissue, the reason being we needed to cover the bone and tendons. And the final result which we need is weight bearing, because she needs to walk. She cannot walk with anything with such a defect. She needs to walk. So we need something which will give her good traction, to support her weight in future. So what we have is something called a latissimus dorsi muscle flap, the latissimus dorsi muscle. It's from the back, mid to lower back, this big muscle there. The reason which we find this particular muscle is it's a big muscle, it's a large muscle. And we needed to cover a large area, so we took the whole muscle. This is the muscle which has been elevated. I don't have the pre-op markings of the muscle, but this is how we elevated the muscle. It's still attached by its blood supply here, supplying the thoracodorsal vessels. It's separated. Here you can see those two arrows. The yellow arrow shows the artery and the vein, and the blue arrow is the nerve supply to the muscle. And what we went ahead and did is we joined this muscle, put it in the defect, in the lower, in the plantar aspect of the defect, and joined the vessel, that is the artery and vein, to the posterior tibial artery and vein. Here is a little magnified picture. This is the flap vessel, flap artery, to the posterior tibial interside anastomosis. This is the flap vein. And immediate postoperative, this is around 12th postoperative day, this is how it looks like. Very edematous. And we covered with the muscle and put a skin graft over it. So So this is how it looks like, very edematous, but over a period of time, 25th post-operative day, the edema has settled down. There is still a long way to go, the edema still comes down much more. All these wounds heal up. And on the 25th, it's now around the 35th day now. So around the 25th post-operative day, these pictures were taken, and she was here taking her first few steps. So this is what we mean. She is undergoing physiotherapy now, taking steps, walking. There are disadvantages with using a muscle flap, but we don't have any choice. Disadvantages which we don't have a choice to correct is it will not be sensate. There will not be sensation over the muscle flap at all. But for the lack of anything better to give her, we are left with the muscle flap. The last case, this is an early middle-aged gentleman, now it's a nasal defect. He came with a history of fighting with his friends. They were all drinking and they were discussing something, and he fought with them and he came off. He blasted them and came off. And when he was sitting in the car, one of his friends came, he had a blade in his hand. Went in through the window, slashed his face, and went so. This is what he came with, a nasal defect. One side of the nose is completely off. And by the way, he was actually giving explanation for his friend's act. He was saying they were drunk, you can't blame them. So anyway, this is how he came. Now, again, this defect, part of the nostril is gone, one half of the nostril is gone, one side is gone. Loss of the left nostril, that is the ala, which is this part of the nostril, part of the tip of the nose, and the malar region. Now the requirements which we need is, of course, skin to cover that area. And the second thing is, for the nose, we have cartilage as foundation instead of the bone. So we need to replace the cartilage. Now what is the requirement, the main thing which we need, the reason for what, why we need to replace the reason why we need to replace the cartilage is because there are these valves, functional valves in the nose, which keeps the nostrils open. If there's no cartilage, it will just collapse. So what we went ahead and did is, first thing, like I said, debridement, remove the non-vascularized tissue. This was the result. And suture as much as possible. In this picture, actually, the remaining ala is pulled up, which was released and brought down later on. And there is this flap called an nasal, called a forehead flap. Now this flap has been described since a very, very long time back, from the times of Sushruta. It's been described. In fact, there was a community of barbers in ancient India who were doing this flap very successfully with beautiful results, which was described in the first few articles published in London. And if we use the same flap, this bit of skin, the reason why this flap is preferred is we need a color match. It's on the face. So if we take something from anywhere else, there will not be a color match. We take something from the forehead based on blood vessels here, which is the supraorbital and supracochlear vessels. The plan was he needed the outer skin, inner lining of the nostril, and cartilage. Here the plan was this part of the flap would be folded in to give a lining to the nostril. This part would give the outer skin, and this is to transport this flap down to the nose. And this is the flap elevated. It's just elevated and put down. And if you see here, it's differentially it's been elevated in the sense that here is only skin. Here its frontalis muscle has been elevated, leaving behind the periosteum. And this bit, even the periosteum, is elevated. The reason being, we need to maintain the blood supply. And this is how it was put back. This was the first stage. This patient, we did it in three stages. But this was the first stage. We were able to close the defect here. And this is the pedicle which is left behind. Now the second stage would come in maybe 15 days. Why 15 days is because in 15 days, this flap will get some vascularity from the recipient site, for the nose itself, there will be blood supply maintained here. This was post 15 days. Now, this was when we went ahead with the second surgery, beginning of know, stage 2, if you look, there is a lot of bulk there. It does not look like a normal nose. So in this stage, what we did is, we opened up again, reflected whatever skin was there, debulked whatever subcutaneous tissue which was giving it that bulk, debulked, removed whatever excess was there as much as possible, looked at the cartilage which was remaining of the normal nose. Now in this stage, we went ahead and got cartilage from the ear. We take cartilage from the ear ulna, shape it into the alar cartilage, and suture it together with the normal cartilage of the nose. So this is from the lower view, worm view, which is from below. So you can see that there is the thinning is quite thin. We have thinned it quite well. And this cartilage, there's a second cartilage here over this region, again taken from the pinna and put there. So basically we are trying to reconstruct the foundation. And it is put back. And now it looks much thinner. When you look from below, it's much thinner. This also looks much thinner. And here a few sutures to try to get the fold in this region. And this was how he was when he came for the third surgery, which is the division of the pedicle. The pedicle is divided, remaining pedicle is put back, and whatever needs to be used here is used to cover the rest of the defect. And this was finally how he looks. He has a good shape of the nose, except for the scarring. There is a good shape of the nose and little bit of bulk in this region. The lateral aspect, this is the normal side, this is the reconstructed side. To an extent, as much as possible, we are able to give him a nose which does not look abnormal. I wouldn't say it's a really great thing, but does not look abnormal. Few scars here and there, people will not suspect such a major surgery has been done. So this is what we try to do. There is always a battle between beauty, what we need, what we want, patient's perfect normal, against blood supply which we need to bring from somewhere else and do. And I stop with this quote. How beautiful was the spectacle of nature not yet touched by the often perverse wisdom of man. Many times we interfere, screw up everything. So by God's grace, this we need to remember whatever we do. Thank you.
In the first case, you did the anastomosis also, the vascular anastomosis. You didn't show that part.
Yes, I didn't show it because the time. We had done it to the facial artery and the facial veins.
The second case, you did a LD plan.
Yes, sir.
With the muscular plan. What yes. Did you take a myocutaneous plan?
The reason being, it's a large area of skin which we need to harvest. The LD flap is, we need to take half the back, and by removing the skin and the muscle, we will expose the scapula and with few of the fascia.
The problem is the foot, you know, with patient walking, because the skin was, though it's a SSC has been put on the donor side.
Yes, sir.
Because to keep on walking, it will break, the skin will going for break, and going for ulcer formation.
Yes, sir.
That is one of the greatest disadvantages in the foot when you put on a SSC.
Yes.
In the sole area.
Yes, sir. Absolutely true. But those are the limitations which we have. The other option is we have something called the ALT flap, anterolateral thigh flap. We can do that. But the problem with the anterolateral thigh or any subcutaneous tissue from anywhere else in the body, there is always a movement. So, for example, here there is always this movement over the underlying tissue. So, while walking, patient is always unsteady. And that's the reason why a muscle flap is preferred. A muscle flap constricts quite well, sticks to the bone, gives a stable platform to stand on. So this against that, we do the best which is possible.
Show me after 2 months, 3 months after the result.
Yes, sir, definitely. And again, this lady, of course, she will not be able to walk without protective footwear, though we have done muscle flap. She would always need protective footwear in the form of silicone sheets, which will protect the skin graft from trauma and wear and tear. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Excellent. In fact, give a big hand once again. Because in the way it was presented, it was like a copy book, you know, like it's so easy to understand. And a lot of plus and minus points of your beauty and
thank you, sir.
I wish you had attached any medical college teaching.
Unfortunately, no, sir.
investigate because such stitches are required actually. And they will give you a crisp picture of what is going to happen. Sir, one question, sir.
Yes, sir.
This first is malignancy case.
Yes, sir.
What are the chances of that flat getting an infiltration of malignancies?
The chance of recurrence is always there, sir. Depends on, I would say, the amount of resection. Oncosurgeon, how much he removes, it depends on that. If the margins are not adequate, or even if there is micro seeding, that can recur. There have been reports, since you asked, there have been reports where instruments have been exchanged from the head side, from the tumor side to the flap side. And by these exchange of instruments itself, there is seeding of malignant cells. And from those seeding of malignant cells, there have been tumor recurrences. Very rare, but it has been reported.
Very happy that function in cancer actually what you must know the functionality is important. You must have a is it good life to have an empty or done a good job. And once again wish you all the success for your
any chance of tissue necrosis?
So there is always a chance of tissue necrosis. In anything we do, that's why it's always a battle between how much we want to do and how much we can do. In free flaps, with a lot of being extremely careful, the success rates of free flaps approximately 90 to 95%, we are able to get. In many cases, the main places where we have problems is where the anastomosis is done, where the blood vessels are joined together. There is always a chance of a thrombus forming there. In those cases, the sooner we go and do a re-exploration, open it up, see where the thrombus is removed and re-anastomose, we can salvage the flap.
Once again thank Dr. request Dr. Srinath of JV Hospital to come and have a certificate appreciation, Dr. Dayananda. He is the right person, he's a surgeon, please.